Great, thank you. And welcome to everyone to our virtual keynote session of the 2021 International Affairs Fellowship Conference. I'm Shannon O'Neill. I'm Vice President and Deputy Director of Studies, as well as the Nelson and David Rockefeller Senior Fellow for Latin America Studies here at the Council on Foreign Relations. And this year's keynote, as many of you know already, is on Taiwan, China, and the United States. And it features a distinguished panel with many of the faces that are right here. You can see with Evan Medeiros, with Nancy Yao Maasbach, with Margaret Lewis, and with Carl Minzner. Now, before we turn to the panel, I just want to say a few words about this program here at CFR. So the mission of the IAF Fellowship is to create a set of scholar practitioners. The idea is to provide a transformative experience for the various fellows that join us each year. Those from academia or the private sector get a chance to spend a year in government. And those who come from the government get a year doing scholarly work in a think tank or in a university setting. We have done this here at the Council on Foreign Relations. We've had the IAF program now for over 54 years, and we've hosted and placed over 650 different IAF scholars or practitioners. So among these are some familiar names in foreign policy. There are people like Ambassador Zalmay Khalilzad. There is the former Secretary of State, Condoleezza Rice. There's the current USAID Administrator, Samantha Power. All of them are alumni of this program, as well as many, many more that many of you probably know. We also have expanded this program over the years. So since the 1990s, there have been additional IAFs added. We have a new IAF in Japan, which is sponsored by Hitachi. An IAF in Canada that's funded by the Power Corporation of Canada, an IAF in India, sponsored by Bharti, an IAF in International Economics that's sponsored by Kimberly Query, and an IAF for tenured IR scholars, which is sponsored by the Carnegie Corporation of New York. So there's many positions and that has expanded over time, something that we hope to continue doing. Now, like many events, the pandemic has changed the shape of the IAF conference over the last 2 years, and this year is no exception. So that's why we're here and pleased to be hosting this in an online forum to have our keynote here to bring together current IAFs as well as former IAFs. And so in addition, given we're all here in this virtual world still at least for a bit longer, we will add to this keynote session, we will be featuring a virtual roundtable series over the summer. So please, in the weeks to come, we hope that you all can join us for that. But meanwhile, let me now turn the meeting over to a former IAF, Carl Minzner, who is going to be the presider for this meeting. He's the professor of law at Fordham University School of Law and will be your host for the rest of this. Thank you all and thank you for joining.
Thank you very much, Shannon, and thanks to all of you for attending. As a former IAF, it's a real honor to get to preside over this distinguished panel with three particular speakers. So I will introduce them first, and then I will proceed to interview and ask questions of them for about half an hour, then turn it over to the question and answer. So for the three excellent speakers that we have today, we have Margaret Lewis from Seton Hall, a professor of law at Seton Hall, specializing particularly in Taiwan-related issues. We have Evan Medeiros, professor at Georgetown University, formerly special assistant to the president and senior director for Asia at the National Security Council. And we have Nancy Yao Maasbach, who's president of the Museum of Chinese in America. And so in lieu of having opening remarks, let me throw out a big picture question, starting particularly with Maggie. So The Economist magazine relatively recently had a very striking headline, which was in a cover photo, which said, picture of Taiwan, the most dangerous place on Earth. You and I are both sitting in Taipei right now, about half a mile away from each other. What's your feeling? I mean, you came here to Taiwan in the middle of the pandemic. What do you think? Most dangerous place on Earth, and what do you feel, and what did your Taiwanese contacts feel?
Oh, thanks, Carl. And I know since we went into soft lockdown, we get to run into each other at Louisa Coffee like we used to. That cover did not go over well, certainly with the people I know here. And it's not because there isn't a recognition that things are tenser across the strait. And certainly, even compared to a few years ago, the risks for some sort of a confrontation, not necessarily militarily, but you know, there's just a lot more action, the gray zone, if we want to use that terminology, a lot more activities in the air. As I say it, it's the my kids saying, I'm not touching you, as the planes get closer to Taiwan without actually, of course, flying over Taiwan, but crossing the midline. We're very aware of that in Taiwan. Of course, I'm American, so I don't want to speak for the Taiwanese people. But what I think the cover was problematic about it, or was a couple things. First, it had the sense of the Taiwan is the unsinkable aircraft carrier, where the visual was this island with a radar emanating from it. And also this idea that there was talking about what China wanted and what the US wanted, but there wasn't much of a voice for Taiwan in that article or a sense of agency. It was much more that Taiwan is a place being acted upon. And even in the video that was put up with the suite of articles, and again, a lot of good information, had pulled some images from old black and white movies of a love triangle with this damsel being torn between two men, putting Taiwan as being tugged between the US and China. And again, putting Taiwan in this passive role and not delving into really talking to people here. Even the quotes were disproportionately not from people in Taiwan or of Taiwanese connections or ancestry. So I think there was a sense of, yes, some important issues, but a more well-rounded view would have talked about what was happening also in Taiwan, and that there's reasons to be concerned, but it was more sensationalist than the situation warranted.
Let me flip over to Evan now. So your response to that particular that particular question, Taiwan, the most dangerous place on the earth?
Well, first, Carl, let me thank you for chairing the panel, the CFR, for convening it. I'm a former IAF. I spent a year at the Treasury Department working for Secretary Paulson, and it was transformational for my career. So I'm really happy that this program has continued for CFR. So is Taiwan the most dangerous place on the planet? I agree with Maggie's assessment. What I see is a gathering storm. I see a perfect storm of sorts. I see a sort of medium to long-term situation that doesn't look stable or sustainable, but is it the most dangerous place on earth? Sounds a little extreme to me. The China-Ukraine border seemed a lot more serious during the time of this publishing. But you know, the problem that I see is we're witnessing a gradual shift in the policies and perceptions about the Taiwan issue among all three actors. And these are not just short-term or cyclical shifts, they are long-term structural shifts, right? In Taiwan, after watching what happened to one country, two systems, in Hong Kong, perceptions of China and Taiwan's future relationship with the mainland have fundamentally changed and sort of shifted to the right. And the fact that you even have the KMT in Taiwan skeptical of embracing the 1992 consensus and a growing belief in Taiwan that perhaps even a maintenance of this, of the status quo is not sustainable, should be worrisome. So in other words, I don't worry about Taiwan politics today because I see Tsai Ing-wen as a very moderate, very careful, very deliberate in how she has managed the cross-strait relationship. Beijing doesn't really give her enough credit for it. What I worry about is the next election. And you know, if Lai Ching-te, her current vice president, runs, what does he do to the party? In China, I see a growing anxiety that appears to be evolving into a sense of urgency, driven by a strong sense of indignation and nationalism. The question is, and I don't have an answer to it, is has the Chinese belief about timeframes changed? I do not believe, that once the PLA has the capability that they're gonna go for it. I think that the Taiwan question for CCP leaders is a political question with a military solution that they would prefer to solve politically. And I think they have a range of military options. The million man swim, large amphibious invasion is in many ways the least likely option. But I think anxiety and concern in the mainland is growing as impatience accumulates. And then lastly, on the US side, what I see is one big fundamental shift, which is in the era of strategic competition, now that it is widely accepted among elites and the public, among Republicans and Democrats, conservatives and liberals, that we're in this new era of long-term, broad-spectrum competition with China, that the Taiwan issue has rapidly evolved. It's no longer an issue that China geeks like myself and Carl, you and Maggie and Nancy sort of, you know, debate about at CFR sessions. The Taiwan issue basically has become a test of American resolve and American willingness to stand up to Taiwan. Stand up to China. So if there's a military conflict over Taiwan, it's not going to be just about Taiwan or US strategy in Asia. It's going to be actually the first major contest in the future of the US-China strategic competition. In other words, in this era of strategic competition, the Taiwan question implicates a broader set of American interests, including questions related to global order. So again, I see a perfect storm, a gathering shift in policies and perceptions that in the medium to long term don't look stabilizing or sustainable, but that doesn't mean that Taiwan is the most dangerous place on earth today.
Let me follow up with both Maggie and Evan on this a little bit. So Evan, you're describing a situation in which basically policies, attitudes on the Taiwan issue in the United States are in some ways are hardening. I mean, the politicization.
Absolutely.
And you're also describing that taking place in Beijing as well. So that then
In Taiwan, Carl, and in Taiwan.
Well, let me flip to that. I'm kind of curious then to get here Maggie respond to that. So in response to what you see in the hardening of attitudes in Beijing and in DC, what do you see, Maggie, in Taiwan? How Taiwanese authorities faced with basically, you know, these two things, both DC and Beijing, what do you see taking place in among political circles in Taipei?
Really complicated. So right now we have Tsai Ing-wen, who has been a very steady hand throughout as far as trying to maintain status quo. Beijing gives her no credit. Beijing is totally unwilling to speak with her. But I think, like Evan said, it's what happens post Tsai. So she, her approval ratings are down, and in part because of the COVID outbreak and questions about whether there was enough done to try to get vaccines far enough ahead of time. Obviously, didn't get them. And part of that is the question about political interference from China, particularly with the BioNTech deal that originally said Taiwan. They were asked to remove it. I think we're still sorting out exactly what happened there. But you've got a spike in COVID. You've got a huge energy issues. We've had rolling brownouts. And then you also drought. She doesn't control the weather. But climate change does seem to be shifting the typhoons. And so there's questions about, you know, is the government planning for what that means for climate change in Taiwan? She's only got a couple years left. Lai Ching-te is her VP, but everything I seem to hear, they're not best friends. But will the DPP swing deeper green, more to the pro-independence? And I want to say that almost in quotes, because Taiwan it's independent. It's not part of the PRC, at least in my view and a lot of other people's view, nor has it ever been a part of the PRC or ruled by that. But I do think that if it swings more to the Lai Ching-te side of the DPP, that would be destabilizing. That's for the Taiwanese people to decide with their votes. The KMT has got who knows who's even going to be chairman, let alone actually their presidential, who's going to run as their candidate. And maybe you're going to see someone who's not your standard KMT, like Ho Yo-yi, the mayor of New Taipei City. There's a long time till 2024. Right now, we're looking to 2022 into the mayoral elections, which will give us at least some sense of how the different parties are doing and who's rising. But I just want to remind you that in 2018, the DPP inside looked like she was down and maybe out, and then she blew away. Had an amazing showing in the presidential election in 2020. So I don't think anyone can put down money on who's going to win. Sorry, Evan. Yep.
No, I was just saying I completely agree with you, but I think the critical variable in understanding Tsai's resurgence in 2019 was Hong Kong, right? I mean, the Chinese crackdown surrounding the riots and the imposition of the national security law. So I agree with you, but there are real reasons why Tsai had her resurgence. And then the other piece of it, of course, is the KMT, right? And Maggie would love to get your views on that, but the KMT doesn't look particularly robust. And they seem to be moving from embracing the 92 consensus to more ambivalent. What do you see?
Well, and also just, I just want to, as far as 2020, Han Kuo-yu was an odd KMT candidate. I don't want to get too inside baseball. So yes, Hong Kong was a big boost to Tsai. And I think she used that very effectively in her campaign with good reason. I think those are the points she made were totally valid. It wasn't just a political ploy, but also that the KMT went with such an unusual presidential candidate also made that a strange race for many reasons. But it's all to say Taiwan politics are complicated and we have a long way to go. But I think there is concern that when we look at not just what's happening in Beijing and DC, but we do need to look at the politics more in Taiwan. And I worry that there's not that many Americans who understand internal politics in Taiwan, that we need more Taiwanese expertise in the US.
Let me make sure to flip, because there's another element to it, which is sort of the internal politics in the United States. And this is where I want to sort of reach to Nancy. So what Evan and Maggie are describing are, you know, is a potential for steadily degrading US-China ties, as well as degrading PRC-Taiwan relations. As that type of dynamic plays out, what's going to be the impact on that on the Chinese and the Taiwanese diaspora in the United States or elsewhere?
No, that's, and thank you, Evan and Maggie, and also thanks, Carl, for this, and also former IAF based in Japan at the Nippon Keidan, where I looked at Japanese relations and how they sort of impede the building of, business relations are not necessarily helpful to China-Japan relations in general, but looking at how those affected economic political ties. But thinking a little bit about the diaspora, it's, we're so heated in the US around identity politics. So this is all sort of converging in the US in an interesting way. You know, identity politics has always been going on in Taiwan. And there's so much, even when you think about, Taiwanese Americans, a lot of people in China, before it was 30-30-30, more like people identify as Western and from 49 to 75 in terms of those who came from the mainland post-Civil War. And then you still had the very Bindiren who really see themselves as Taiwanese, and even, affiliate a little bit with the Japanese that infuriate the mainland Chinese. So that was about 30%. And then you have this sort of nondescript group of 30%. That's shifted quite a bit. And with what we've seen is also two generations, right? When we were dealing with this in the 70s and 80s, you're looking really at one generation, and that generation was being taught Mandarin as the national language, Guoyu, right? In schools, Taiwanese was not permissible until the early 90s when you taught that in China, in schools in Taiwan. So now what you have is really the second generation into adulthood. You have the celebrities like Constance Wu. You have celebrities like Jeremy Lin, though he does a lot of work in basketball in China, still self-described and self-identity as Taiwanese American. And you have elected officials like Grace Meng, who gets a lot of attention as a head of the Democratic National Party and putting across his anti-AAPI COVID-19 hate crimes bill. You have Elaine Chao, who also depicts and identifies as Taiwanese American. And yet my parents, for example, though they left Civil War 49, went to Taiwan, they will never claim their identity as Taiwanese. And there's still that large pool of Weishenmen, or the ones who left China in Civil War and went to Taiwan, then came to the United States, make up that diaspora, who will always claim their Chinese identity and feels that the world is attacking China. And it's interesting because what you have here now is, although there's so much Taiwanese American organizations that have surfaced over now two generations, whether it be professionals like the Taiwanese American professionals or the Formosan Association for Public Affairs, the Taiwanese American Citizens League, there's all this activation of lobby groups, and we've seen them in different ways. And we see them actually in very mainstream think tanks as well, where there's a clear bias and proclivity toward Taiwan independence and Taiwanese-ness that comes out in a lot of different ways. And that's really their way to have a voice in this whole dialogue. But what we see on the US side is really a misunderstanding of what's going on. I think that has always been a fundamental desire to create a Chinese monolith, desire to create a Taiwanese monolith that no one really understands the layeredness and the nuances within that, whether it's from as early as Dutch, rule to Japanese colonialism to, or why do they appreciate the Japanese, 1945, wait, martial law, all these different components of Taiwan history, is sort of converge in this extremely complicated, nuanced layeredness that my bet would be that most people in DC don't really understand that layeredness around that identity. And that's, I think, the trickiest part of that sort of general sentiment around identity in the United States for people who claim Taiwanese-ness, who I would suggest, if you claim Taiwanese-ness, you are in essence fully correlated with Taiwan independence and recognition as a Taiwan independent state. So even there are Chinese people who do not believe that they should be Taiwan independent. They will never say Taiwanese. They will not use that phrase to self-describe. And that's very, very clear in Mandarin when you're thinking about this Taiwanese independence and self-determination question. But at the same time, and I'll leave it at this, there is this proclivity toward hopping on the winning horse. And I think that that's further complicated in the last 6 years with the US administration, as far as there is a correlation that even during World War II, when China was your friend, Japan was your enemy. And then during McCarthyism, wait, China is now your enemy. Japan can be your friend. And now it's like, China's your enemy, Taiwan's your friend. Taiwan's your enemy, China's your friend. It's always gonna be this binary sort of layout. So I think the identity politics needs to be factored into this overall conversation.
So it sounds like all three of you are describing is a situation in which kind of Taiwan itself kind of gets flattened out and kind of emerges just as an issue in broader political debates within DC. So maybe one operative question then to ask, and I'll go back to Maggie on this, is what does Taiwan actually want in terms of with regard to the United States? I mean, you're the one who's having the most, you're having contacts with Taiwanese officials. What are you hearing from them in terms of what they actually want from the United States at this point?
I don't want to act as I'm giving a mouthpiece for anyone. I just am soaking in, having spent not just time this past year, but I've been coming to Taiwan for 15 plus years and lived here before. And I think this idea of complexity is so important, because it is frustrating when I hear out of DC, and particularly out of members of Congress, this sort of, I'm pro Taiwan because I'm anti not just China, but anti CCP and anti communist China. And that really puts this into the enemy of enemy is my friend, instead of asking, is this good policy for Taiwan? And there I would go with Bonnie Glazer's do no harm. You know, when it sometimes feels good to have sort of pro Taiwan legislation, but you have to think through, you know, where is that really getting you? Not just saying we support Taiwan, but would the US follow through on what it's saying? And I think that this is, you know, of course Taiwan needs military support. The question is what kind, and as Taiwan has moved more to this asymmetric defense, which is really the way it has to go. And I've had that described to me as being a porcupine or a hedgehog or a turtle, any sort of creature that's not particularly fierce, but has a defensive covering. That's what Taiwan needs to be, because it is smaller and it is unlikely, as Evan says, to be all these, you know, just boats showing up on the shore. But could people be resilient and handle if electricity went out, if the grid went out in a cyber attack, if their cell phones went out? And here, I do think this is one thing that doesn't get enough attention, is the shift to a voluntary military has not gone well here. And one issue is there's just not many young people because of the massively aging demographics, which creates all sorts of problems for Taiwan. But there's not a sense of going into military service as generally being something that is desirable and patriotic. And I think that I really hope that that can shift, because for the U.S. to back Taiwan, it's also very important that people in the U.S. are seeing that Taiwan is putting money and people behind, energizing their defense. So I would just, I'll leave it there because I know time is short, and see what others have to add on.
Perfect segue to go back to Evan. So Evan, what do you think the United States should be doing in response to the issues that you yourself outlined? Some people have sort of advocated for the United States. There's a council special report that came out in February, which seemed to be advocating for a more highly public tripwire function for the US to try to create a situation in which Beijing would more clearly understand action on their part might lead to Japanese rearmament, American deaths, yeah, and use that tripwire function as a deterrent. I think Richard Haas had suggested that maybe the United States government should be reconsidering making its support for Taiwan sort of public. Your opinions on what the correct policy choice is for the U.S.
Yeah, so, you know, I'm going to sort of, for the sake of entertainment and to make this an even more engaging discussion, I'm going to disagree with Maggie a little bit. I think that you can overcomplexify these issues. There's a whole group of people, I consider myself one of them, in the United States that have studied cross-strait dynamics, Taiwan's defense requirements, Taiwan's security and Taiwan politics for a very, very long time. So look, everything in international politics is complex. That's why I chose my career path. I like complex things and I like untangling them. But the Taiwan issue is probably the most studied issue in the U.S.-China relationship, largely because, you know, it is the original challenge that bedeviled the relationship from, you know, the very inception, right? I mean, from Kissinger's first trip in 1971. And so I think that it's important to start with the question that you talked about, you raised initially, Carl, what does Taiwan want? And I think what Taiwan wants at this point is a combination of freedom from coercion, right? The ability to determine, to have greater control over their own future. I think they want a greater degree of international space. I think they want respect and dignity commensurate with their accomplishments as a, you know, as a political system, you know, as an international actor, as a globally competitive economy with some of the best companies in the world, TSMC being the most obvious example. So it sort of collectively adds up to a degree of strategic autonomy. And so the question for the United States becomes, given where Taiwan's capabilities are and what they want, and given where the mainland is, what should the United States do? And, you know, surprise, surprise, it is a multi-layered solution. I mean, I spent, you know, as you know, 6 years at the Obama NSC. We spent a lot of time working on this issue. It was different for us because Ma Ying-jeou was president and there was a much more stable status quo between Taipei and Beijing, in large part because Beijing was confident that Ma Ying-jeou wasn't going to move from de facto to de jure independence, which is really the strategic reality that we're talking about today. And so the question is, what combination of policies can the United States adopt? Economic policies, policies regarding international space, and then of course, deterrence and defense that will give Taiwan a greater degree of freedom from coercion, strategic autonomy, dignity, and respect. And I think that those, I would encourage people to look at a CSIS report that Maggie and I were part of. It was a task force co-chaired by Bonnie Glaser, Richard Bush, and Mike Green, where we looked at what would a forward-looking sort of aggressive American approach to Taiwan look like. And it was about the U.S. doing more with Taiwan, not in a way that would sort of fundamentally rewrite the One China policy, which is an important foundational dimension of cross-strait stability, but would be a series of incremental but significant and meaningful ways to give Taiwan the dignity and respect it deserves and to improve its security. But at the end of the day, ultimately, Taiwan's fate is in the hands of the Taiwan elite and the Taiwan public, and they're going to need to do more, right? And I give Tsai Ing-wen an enormous amount of credit for finally pushing through the asymmetric, innovative defense strategies. I mean, we used to talk about this with Ma Ying-jeou and his administration till we were blue in the face, but they simply were unwilling for a variety of reasons to make those defense commitments. And Taiwan under Tsai Ing-wen has started to buy the equipment that they need. Now, of course, as the United States has looked for different ways to give Taiwan dignity and respect, albeit within the One China principle, Beijing's view is, oh, you're hollowing out the One China policy and hence the current state of cross-strait relations. So as, you know, as Thomas Schelling taught us all, and as Tom Christensen regularly reminds us, deterrence is a mix of threats and assurances, right? And I think the United States needs to get Taiwan to do more. I think the United States needs to continue to be serious about both its commitments to give Taiwan the defense equipment it needs, but also the United States needs to get more serious about the deterrence equation in the Western Pacific and the Pacific Defense Initiative that the Congress has passed, and hopefully it will be implemented, the money will be allocated, and you know, we start buying what we need, will be taken seriously in light of PLA modernization. And at some point, the Biden administration is gonna need to have a serious discussion with the mainland about what US policy is and isn't as a way to reinforce deterrence, but also to express displeasure with China's growing use of coercion. Over to you.
I'm instructed that I need to stop and have questions and answers, but I'm gonna throw one question at Nancy. You can answer when, in perhaps in some response to some of the participants, which is, I'm curious to hear, in an escalating environment where US-China relations are degrading, what's the correct policy for the Biden administration with respect to internal politics in the United States, Chinese Americans, and this potential for these tensions to spill over within US society? But I'll turn it over. I want to get to allow others to answer, ask questions as well. So I believe Kayla will handle it from here.
Okay. And maybe as she's getting those questions together, I think what we also don't see as clearly, but we do hear about anecdotally at the museum, is also what's being taught in China and what's being taught in Taiwan in the books around history. So, 5,000 years of Chinese history used to be mandated in the education on Taiwan, and now it's really been sort of reduced substantially over a number of years to much less than what it used to be, which was predominantly the history that was taught. And also, I think in China, what we do find that 300,000 Chinese international students are in the US in 2019, and many of those have a very keen, direct, 100% consensus that Taiwan is a province of China. So we have now this US as this sort of intellectual battlegrounds for our Chinese students studying here, much fewer Taiwanese or Taiwan students studying here. And that, there's a great sense that this next generation sees what's happening in Hong Kong, saw what happened in Hong Kong post-protests, and that the international reputation of Taiwan has really been more in line with sort of the next gen, which I think is a really interesting variable, because whether it be same-sex marriage and the beginning parts of how Taiwan handled the COVID-19 situation that got slowed down with the vaccination efforts. But I think their international reputation is much more in line with what the US kind of understands and relates to. And I think that's very dangerous to look at that at face value without understanding the consensus that was taught in China and on the mainland as far as how people view Taiwan. There is no space for a different viewpoint, I think, for those who are from the PRC more recently. If they've come to the US and they know how to kind of open up their understanding, but there's full consensus on how the view on Taiwan, from someone who's an international student who has been here for less than 5 years, I would say. And I think that dynamic is very misunderstood by the Biden administration and many administrations in the past, that again, echoing Maggie, like the complexity around this is just, there is so much more at that sort of populist boiling point that we don't really see that can really escalate quite quickly.
Kayla, you want to take over?
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, as a reminder, to ask a question, please click on the raise hand icon on your Zoom window. When you are called on, please accept the unmute now button and proceed with your name, affiliation, and question. To view the roster of participants registered to attend this meeting, please click on the link in your Zoom chat box. We'll take the first question from Brandon Archuleta.
Hi, everybody. I'm Brandon Archuleta. I'm a current CFR IAF, currently at the Treasury Department, looking at these China-related issues. And in my previous assignment, I was an Army war planner in the Pentagon, and we wrestled with Taiwanese will to fight. And so, Nancy, you mentioned this point about the layered identity, and Maggie, you talked about this porcupine defense, and Evan, you mentioned the strategic imperatives. And I'd be interested to really get your thoughts on the sort of circumstances necessary to galvanize Taiwanese will to fight. Thanks so much.
Okay. There's always these lots of polling in Taiwan, and I'm not someone who understands polls, but I know that you don't trust any poll you see until you talk to someone who really does trust polls, because a lot of them aren't very good. But one question that does get asked is, would you fight if Taiwan was invaded? And then there's some that ask also, well, do you think your neighbor would fight? And people, I guess those tend to say more likely that they would fight than their neighbors, because it hasn't been tested. And so this is speculation. But I do think this point that Nancy is raising is so critical about the Taiwanese identity, because for decades now, there has been very solid polling, tracking, and asking people periodically, do you consider yourself Chinese? Do you consider yourself Taiwanese or both? You know, because the people that have dual identities. And in the last year or so, they hit an all-time high of just Taiwanese. I think it was about 70%, but it's now 12:30 in the morning here. So don't, we'll go back and check that. But regardless, that this pure Taiwanese identity. So I think that feeds into a sense of willingness to stand up for your country and Republic of China, Taiwan. We can go into that conversation too about what the ROC means today here, which has been, I think, in many ways, very smartly kind of repackaged in some ways by Tsai. But I do think that it's one thing to say we'll fight, but they do need to get better participation in the military. And Tsai is trying, but that's a long-term project.
Why don't I jump in here? Ooh, sorry, Nancy, go ahead. I agree with Maggie. I think it's, even though to date the polling suggests that the people of Taiwan are sort of happy with this indeterminate status quo, on the questions of identity, the sense of Taiwanese identity has only become stronger, and that's only going to change with time. And, I think that the minute serious Chinese military coercion starts, I think that changes the equation fundamentally. So, if either the United States and or mainland China are sort of, or I should say, if mainland China is basing its strategy on a collapse of the will of the people of Taiwan, I think that's probably a pretty shaky basis to work on. But the reality is there's no good way to test, the will to fight of any particular country until it actually happens. So it's a hard problem to solve.
As a reminder to the audience also, there is still compulsory military service in Taiwan. So if you're a male between the ages of 18 and 36, you may be able to be called on and subject to compulsory military service, which I think is not just something that needs to happen if you're in that age bracket or that group, but also it reminds us what the culture is of Taiwan, that you're going to fight for Taiwan. And I think that is a powerful variable within that identity politics as well. And if anyone has ever observed, the parliament and the passion around, this is also since 45 in essence, this is a passionate, engaged. I mean, this is not under socialist rule. I mean, we see a different type of, society. And, there's, I think a lot of people from Taiwan and Taiwanese pride themselves on being engaged in a way that you don't see, and not having limits on that, especially in the last 40 years, post 77 in essence. But there is that identity and that fight to protect. I think that is a prevalent sort of current, among on the island in Taiwan.
We'll take the next question from James Gilmore. Mr. Gilmore, please accept.
Now can I be heard now? I can be heard. Okay, great. I'm Jim Gilmore. I'm the immediate past ambassador of the OSCE in Vienna. And the reason I've come on the call today is I want to learn from the participants the level of danger that actually exists here from the threat of the People's Republic of China. That's what I'm trying to understand. It's my growing sense, having spent a great deal of time in Europe and specifically in the past weeks in Ukraine, that there's a great danger in Europe right now. And the concern I've got is that if there's going to be a cross-strait threat that comes in from China, that the U.S. is going to end up in a war almost inadvertently. And I'm worried about it. And the reason I've come on the call is because I want to try to understand the level of danger that's going on here. Because if they end up in a, if we end up in a war in Ukraine, not in a war, but a conflict of some kind in Ukraine, and then at the same time something's happening in Taiwan, this can get out of hand really quick. And I think I have not heard so far from the participants how dangerous this really is over there. So that's really what I wanted to ask.
Maybe we can direct that to Evan. Short-term, medium-term, what do you think we're thinking?
Sure. So, Jim, I think the way to think about it is in the short term, right? So right now, the principal risk is in an accident that escalates. So you have every time that the United States or Taiwan do something that, that mainland China finds objectionable, like a high-level visit, something like that, the Chinese will send these strike packages. So these large packages of aircraft, fighters, bombers, AWACS, et cetera. Sometimes it used to be over the center line of the Taiwan Strait. More recently, in recent weeks, it's been in the southwest corner of Taiwan's ADIS, so not over the center line. And so the principal risk is as Taiwan sends up fighters to intercept them, that there is some sort of collision in the air, and then that situation escalates. That's the principal scenario today. But here's the thing. Taiwan recently declared that it's not going to intercept every Chinese military aircraft that comes into its ADIS or its airspace. The fact that the Chinese have shifted from the center line air interdiction activities to the conducting these flights in the southwest corner of the ADIS sort of takes the temperature down a little bit. And the U.S. government is not, I mean, the U.S. Air Force is not involved in this, you know, particular activity. So it's an accident, which I don't see as a particularly, I mean, there is a risk there, but the fact that both sides are attendant, you know, are aware of that risk, the fact that the Chinese have principally changed the location, though they could change it back, the fact that the Taiwan Air Force has said we're not going to intercept every Chinese flight tells me that they're being careful. The medium-term risk is a combination of the fact that Chinese military capabilities are growing, and there's a variety of estimates about where their capabilities will be by the end of the decade. But perhaps, you know, there's some estimates that say by the late 2020s, they will have sufficient amphibious lift capability that if they wanted to conduct a full invasion, though, again, full invasion is not exactly the ideal scenario from a Chinese perspective because it triggers a long, potentially costly, difficult war with the United States and perhaps others in Asia. So the real risk is medium term. Chinese capabilities grow, and as I outlined at the beginning, changes in perceptions among all three actors. So that's why I said I don't think that the economist is right. It's not like Russia amassing tanks and APCs, you know, along the border with Ukraine. It doesn't rank as that kind of risk in terms of immediacy. But look, there's always the risk of an accident. And the fact that there's very poor communication channels between Taipei and Beijing really hinders their ability to manage an accident if it occurs. So I would put the risk, you know, in that basket. Carl, over to you.
Hey, Carl, can I mention one thing on the sort of the rhetoric around it also, though? I think it was in 2019, Xi Jinping said that to achieve the China dream, we need reunification. So in terms of like the message that Beijing is sending out, I think that that's very, very strong. Because especially as we see more and more that Taiwanese independence is getting stronger, that obviously conflicts with the growth of China and China's ability to achieve its dream. So, that's what concerns me when there's like official rhetoric out there.
So Nancy, let me come in on this, because Nancy's point is a really important and really significant one. So in 2019, when Xi Jinping linked China Dream with national rejuvenation with unification, right? That was the key link. That was interesting and new. But here's the thing. Nobody knows exactly what that is. The best guess is that it's 2049, right? So that's still about 30 years away, which is a long time. And then the other thing is Xi Jinping is a smart enough political leader to know that, you know, giving himself a timeline sort of puts himself in a box, easy for him to talk about 2049, he's probably not going to be around then. So Nancy's absolutely right that the Chinese have now made this linkage between reunification and rejuvenation. A lot of debate about what that means. That's raising the temperature, creating more anxiety. Some people feel more urgent than others. And what's really interesting is that some people have begun in the mainland have begun talking about 2027, which is the 100th anniversary of the founding of the People's Liberation Army, as perhaps, another interesting benchmark. So Nancy's absolutely right. There are all these sort of interesting timelines out there, 2049, the 100th anniversary of the founding of the PRC, 2035, which are Xi Jinping's midterm goals, 2027. So we really don't know, but there is this growing sense of, anxiety, and we have to monitor that.
So I just said on the Taiwan side that I think it'd be very surprising if there was a referendum that actually was put in place and succeeded in changing the name to the Republic of Taiwan from the Republic of China and then using Taiwan. I mean, a lot of people know that the years here are still counted from 1912, the founding of the Republic of China at that point in mainland China. And I think there is generally comfort with the status quo of having the ROC as at least a historical anchor, and still with the, I think, 15 diplomatic partners with the entity that has international relations, but using Taiwan. I think it'd be very surprising if there was a push for formal independence under the name of the Republic of Taiwan. On the China side, I totally agree. There's all these dates, and a big unknown unknown is how much does Xi Jinping want this? How much does he want to outdo Deng Xiaoping and have Taiwan? We just don't know that. And I think anyone who says they can look into his eyes or read something that's coming, do some reading the tea leaves, it's just a lot of speculation. But I think short-term risk, I agree with Evan, is pretty low. And then as we get more medium to long-term, and there's also just so many variables that it gets really difficult to estimate.
I just also flag that, I think the unstable internal politics within China itself, how does the Xi Jinping's push for more power himself play with how do you play the Taiwan card? I mean, it could work both ways. It could be a threat to your own power, but it could also be a unifying rally if you're trying to build support. So it's also, I think, indeterminate. More questions from Kayla from the audience.
We'll take the next question from Iris Ferguson.
Hi, thank you all for hosting this. I'm a senior advisor for Air Force Futures, or in the Department of Air Force, and I was a previous IAF fellow in Canada looking at US and Canadian space policy and the commercialization of space. My question has to do with neighboring nations and other Asian nations within the region. As the Department of Defense places a strong focus on allies and partners, especially as we talk about competition with China. And, for the US piece of this, we place heavy prominence on the Taiwan problem set. But I'm curious if other Asian nations see the Taiwan problem set to be so large, or would they care if Taiwan was invaded? Would be really curious of y'all's perspectives. Thank you.
Start with either Maggie or with Evan on this one. You guys want to?
Maggie, please.
Japan does care. The question is how much, how publicly they're going to say it, and what would they do? And it's been interesting. I'm delighted to see the return of talking about friends, partners, allies from DC. And you've seen this push by the Biden administration to have the Japanese government say more about their support for Taiwan. And the statement that came out was mild, but there was a reiteration of the importance. And I think a lot of this is what's going to be the post-Suga government. And I think there's a lot of questions there, particularly with concerns about how COVID has impacted Japan so greatly, and who will be in after Suga. South Korea, other places care about Taiwan, but the U.S. It really does, I think, need to do some work and trying to create more international space for Taiwan, both in this region, as Evan mentioned, and internationally through organizations, through having everything from just informal talks. And we've seen some relaxation, for example, in the contact guidelines, so that we have U.S. ambassadors, different places now able to meet more with their Taiwanese unofficial counterparts. But yes, there is action afoot. How much traction we'll get, I think it's early to say.
I agree with Maggie. I think she got it exactly right. Iris, the reality of the region is that nobody cares as much about Taiwan as the United States does, right? No other country has a Taiwan Relations Act type of piece of legislation. Nobody has a one China policy like the United States does, right? Because the mainland has forced them to sort of adopt more of a one China principle. Japan cares, South Korea cares, but they care largely because their view is, if China gets away with grabbing Taiwan, what does that mean for the strategic environment in the Asia Pacific? And you know, am I Japan next or South Korea? Are we next? I think the challenge for the United States is that the U.S. is much more willing to assume risk, take on turbulence in the U.S.-China relationship to support Taiwan, right? And, Japan is probably, next best in Asia. But the Biden team had to do quite a bit of arm twisting to persuade Seoul to simply have a line in the joint statement that said that, both presidents, Biden and Moon, agree that peace and security in the Taiwan Strait is critical to the Asia Pacific. But yet the word China never appears in the joint statement. And the South Koreans have been talking about how that's a victory for them, right? And so, I think the key thing to keep in mind is that in Asia, right, the basic strategic reality is nobody wants China to dominate. Nobody wants to choose between the United States and China. And the Taiwan issue is one of those very uncomfortable issues in the middle of that reality, because the more countries in Asia, whether it's Singapore or Indonesia, talk about their unofficial relationship with Taiwan, the more the Chinese squeeze them, right? The more they're faced with a strategic dilemma. And, very few of them have the kind of historic cultural ties that Nancy talked about, the people-to-people ties, and with the United States under the TRA, this sense that America has a great responsibility for, protecting peace and stability across the Taiwan Strait. And that's a, very unique American responsibility. And I think the more, the U.S. tries to pull other countries into this, it's going to be a challenge, but it's the kind of challenge I think it's very important to assume right now, because it sends a strong signal to Beijing that its growing coercion of Taiwan, military coercion, diplomatic isolation, economic coercion, is costly and alienating to China's other important relationships in Asia. Over to you, Carl.
Can take one more question. We have 6 minutes left. So, Kayla, if there's one more.
We'll take the next question from Amy Austin Holmes.
Hi, thank you so much for this fascinating discussion today. I'm a current international affairs fellow in the current cohort, and I previously taught at the American University in Cairo for almost a decade, actually. So I come at this more from the perspective of a Middle East person. And my question is, there's been obviously a lot of discussion about China promoting the Belt and Road Initiative and their economic outreach to countries in the Middle East and Africa, et cetera. But there's also been a tendency, for example, for Egypt seemingly to emulate the political mechanisms of repression that China has sort of, that Egypt under Sisi for the past 5 years has seemingly been emulating, for example, the limiting the number of children that families should have. So it mean kafaya, they call it in Arabic, two is enough. So emulating the one child policy in China, limiting NGOs, press freedoms, limiting the topics that students can write their theses about, even, you know, using technology, Uber ride sharing apps to track people down, things like that. So my question is, to what extent is this something that China is promoting and others like autocratic countries like Egypt are following? Or is it more a question of Egypt just simply trying to sort of follow the Chinese example, if that makes sense? So who is the initiative coming from, if you could say anything about that? And has Taiwan done anything at all to push back on some of this? Because it's worrying for me personally if Egypt is actually, you know, going to become another China in the Middle East in terms of the, you know, severe levels of political repression of their own population. Thank you.
Export of the China model, first to Nancy and then to others. Is it?
I, from my seat, I don't see that as an active movement. You know, a lot of, I just remember Kirk Campbell said, you know, in the mid 90s, he was like, you really don't have to worry about China's military. They're about 15 years behind. I think there's assumption about China being much more organized, much more farther along in, at times in terms of their export. But I think the BRI is really where you're seeing much of the effort and the work. But I'm going to toss it over to Evan. I don't see it as a real movement right now. And I'm not, you know, so I'll
Carl, do you want me to jump in?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so it's a good question. It's a hard question because the evidence, I think, is not terribly clear. I'll tell you the way I think about it, is that what I'm trying to decide is to what extent is China conducting activities externally that seeks to legitimize or validate its governance choices, economic and political governance, right? Sort of the whole world, the idea being China's approach is to make, you know, its governance choices just as valid as American ones, right? And we hear more and more, or I hear more and more indignation in the Chinese when Americans and others criticize them. So on the one hand, you have the sort of legitimizing, validating argument. Then there's another argument on the other side. You know, scholars like Liz Economy argue that the Chinese have crossed the line from legitimizing to proselytizing. In other words, they are really, you know, they're moving beyond making the world safe for their choices, but actively promoting them. And so the question becomes, to what extent are they actually tearing down or undermining democracies, right? That's sort of one dimension of it. And the evidence is unclear. And to what extent are they sort of super empowering autocracies? I see more evidence on the sort of helping autocracies, like Egypt, for example, giving internal security services the technology that they need. But the Chinese have been doing that for a long time. That's not terribly new. And I don't see a lot of evidence of them yet tearing down democracies, though it's mixed. I mean, I haven't made a definitive conclusion yet for myself, because there's evidence in Eastern Europe of them taking actions that look like they're weakening democratic processes. You see some of this in Africa as well. So I don't know. I mean, look, Maggie's the lawyer. I'd love to get, you know, Maggie's take on this as well. What do you think, Maggie?
Yeah, we have a minute, and I'm a human rights person. So I am concerned about Beijing's influence on international human rights norms, and I'd love to have a whole hour on that. But this is about Taiwan. So I do want to end with bringing it back to what a success story Taiwan is. It was under martial law for four decades. The first direct presidential election wasn't until 1996. And when bringing it to The Economist, by moving my family from the United States back to Taiwan, we went from a quote, flawed democracy to a full democracy. So Taiwan has a lot of challenges, but it also has marriage equality. It has amazing public protests. It has a former hacker turned digital minister. So there's so much to celebrate here at a time that the world is really struggling to find, I think, those beacons of light for democracy. So I do hope that with all the concerns about the military situation, that those stories will get out too about Taiwan's successes.
And with that, I think we will conclude. Thanks to Nancy, to Maggie, and to Evan for participating. And thanks to all of you from the IAF program. It's a great program. Thank you for participating. We'll look forward to seeing you in person, hopefully, over the next year.